grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
The melons, the leeks, the onions, and the garlic. But now our strength is dried up, and there is nothing at all but this manna to look at. Moses heard the people weeping through their families, throughout their families, all at the entrances of their tents. Then the Lord became very angry, and Moses was displeased. So Moses said to the Lord, "Why have you treated your servant so badly? Why have I not found favor in your sight that you lay the burden of all this people on me? Did I conceive all this people? Did I give birth to them that you should say to me, 'Carry them in your bosom as a nurse carries a sucking child to the land that you promised on oath to their ancestors'? Where am I to get meat to give to all this people? For they come weeping to me and say, 'Give us meat to eat.' I am not able to carry all this people alone, for they are too heavy for me. If this is the way you are going to treat me, put me to death at once, if I have found favor in your sight, and do not let me see my misery." So the Lord said to Moses, "Gather for me 70 of the elders of Israel, whom you know to be the elders of the people and officers over them. Bring them to the tent of meeting and have them take their place there with you." So Moses went out and told the people the words of the Lord, and he gathered 70 elders of the people and placed them all around the tent. Then the Lord came down in the cloud and spoke to him and took some of the spirit that was on him and put it on the 70 elders. And when the spirit rested upon them, they prophesied, but they did not do so again. Two men remained in the camp, one named Eldad and the other Medad, and the Spirit rested on them. They were among those registered, but they had not gone out to the tent, and so they prophesied in the camp. And a young man ran and told Moses, "Eldad and Medad are prophesying in the camp." And Joshua, son of Nun, the assistant of Moses, one of his chosen men, said, "My lord Moses, stop them." But Moses said to him, "Are you jealous for my sake? Would that all the Lord's people were prophets, and that the Lord would put his spirit on them." Here ends the first lesson.
All right.
Today's psalm is Psalm 19, verses 7 to 14. The teaching of the Lord is perfect and revives the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure and gives wisdom to the simple.
The statutes of the Lord are just and rejoice the heart. The commandment of the Lord is clear and gives light to the eyes.
The fear of the Lord is clean and endures forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether.
More to be desired are they than gold, more than much fine gold, sweeter far than honey in the comb.
By them also is your servant enlightened, and in keeping them there is great reward.
Who can accept Muslim offenses? Cleanse me from my secret faults.
Above all, keep your servant from presumptuous sins. Let them not get dominion over me. Then shall I be whole and sound, and innocent of a great offense.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer.
The second reading for today is taken from James 5, verses 13 through 20. Are any among you suffering? They should pray. Are any cheerful? They should sing songs of praise. Are any among you sick? They should call for the elders of the church and have them pray over them, anointing them with oil in the name of the Lord. The prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise them up, and anyone who has committed sins will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another so that you may be healed. The prayer of the righteous is powerful and effective. Elijah was a human being like us, and he prayed fervently that it might not rain. And for 3 years and 6 months, it did not rain on the earth. Then he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth yielded its harvest. My brothers and sisters, if anyone among you wanders from the truth and is brought back by another, you should know that whoever brings back a sinner from wandering will save the sinner's soul from death and will cover a multitude of sins. Here ends the reading.
I invite the kids to come up for a little message. Jesus is saying a lot of things happen in this gospel. First thing that happens is that is that one of them says, Jesus, we saw this guy, and he was casting out demons in your name, and we tried to stop it because he wasn't following us. So they were wanting to make sure that only the right people were doing things the right way. Is that a little more? So they wanted to make sure that was only them and the people who were following them who would be doing things in Jesus' name. Because they figured they had it right. So they tried to stop them. Well, Jesus said, why did you stop them? He said, nobody who does something powerful in my name will soon afterwards be able to say bad things about me. Somebody who's doing good in the name of Jesus is doing good in the name of Jesus. That's it. And then Jesus says, look, he had just said that about something powerful. He said, I tell you, even somebody who gives you a cup of water in my name will lose their reward. There's a lot more things that Jesus talks about. And it's not really about the reward thing, but it's about doing something that's good in Jesus' name. And it's not just about the cup of water, but think about this. If you're paying attention, if we're paying attention to one another, and we notice something as small as whether somebody might be thirsty, right? And you notice that they might be thirsty, and you give them water. You're noticing, you're caring about that person, what they might need, right? So if you're noticing something that small and caring about them, you probably will notice other things that they need, like if they're sad, like if they're hungry, like if other things aren't good for them, you probably notice those things too. And if you could do something as small as give a cup of water to somebody who needs it, probably try to do other things to try to help someone. And that's the thing that Jesus is saying here about what life in his name is about. Because God loves everybody already, okay? So we don't, like, by taking care of somebody or by giving somebody a cup of water or whatever, that's not about, like, making God love us by doing good things. That's not how it works. God already loves us, okay? But to do something good for someone else is just about caring for one another. It's about sharing that love of God. It's about trying to just take care of each other in the name of Jesus. Doing a good thing because it's a good thing. And this is what life and following Jesus is about. Caring for one another. The way that God cares for us. Because God has loved each of us, then we just try to share that with one another. We try to help take care of one another. And this idea about who can be a part of that, anybody who's trying to do the work of Jesus, anybody who's trying to take care of other people, even a small thing as a cup of water, well, they're part of doing God's work. If there's the truth. Right? Yep. So, because God loves us, cares for us, and gives us eternal life, then part of following God's way is to try to care for one another. And who's a part of that? Just everybody who wants to be trying to follow God and to share Jesus' love. Let's pray. God, we thank you that you care for us so much that you give us everything that we need. And help us to look out for one another, for other people and their needs, to notice things that one another needs, and to share your love and care for one another. In Jesus' name. John said to Jesus, "Teacher, we saw someone casting out demons in your name, and we tried to stop him because he was not following us." Jesus said, "Do not stop him, for no one who does a deed of power in my name will be able soon afterward to speak evil of me. Whoever is not against us is for us. For truly I tell you, whoever gives you a cup of water to drink because you bear the name of Christ, by no means lose the reward. If you put a stumbling block before one of these little ones who believe in me, it would be better for you if a great millstone hung around your neck and were thrown into the sea. And if your hand causes you to stumble, cut it off. It's better for you to enter life maimed than to have two hands and go to hell, to unquenchable fire. And if your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off. Or it's better for you to enter life lame than to have 2 feet and be thrown into hell. And if your eye causes you to stumble, tear it out. It's better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than to have 2 eyes and be thrown into hell, where the worm never dies and the fire is never quenched. For everyone will be salted with fire. Salt is good, but if salt is lost in saltiness, how can you season it? Have salt in yourselves and be at peace with one another." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Started off this morning with a little video clip, just a minute and a half, and this is from a movie, Monty Python and the Holy Grail, and it's silly humor, but goes to a little bit of a point. So. such child in my name welcomes me. Whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me. This is what Jesus is about, transforming, welcoming, serving love. And so then Jesus' disciples, they follow that up with this. Teacher, we saw someone casting out demons in your name, and we tried to stop him because he wasn't following us. Now, I think when I read this, I can actually hear Jesus' eyes rolling from 2,000 years away. Jesus, maybe trying to count to 10, biting his tongue, but still he's got to say something. Don't stop him! You're stopping somebody from doing good in my name? Don't stop him! For no one who does a deed of power in my name, Jesus said, will soon after be able to speak evil things about me. Somebody is doing good in the name of Jesus. They're doing good. Whoever is not against us is for us. This person was helping people. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' power. Somebody not included because they weren't following those disciples or their idea of how things should be, they're not part of doing God's work, they're not part of God's kingdom. Disciples seem to think so. Jesus is talking about who's included. Anybody who wanted to be a part of the work of Jesus. A short list of requirements there. Jesus says, whoever gives you even a cup of water to drink because you bear the name of Christ will by no means lose the reward. Talking with Rick about this before service, and brought me a cup of water. I said, you'll by no means lose your reward. We were talking about it's a pretty low standard. And it is. Right? But here's what Jesus says. It's anybody who wants to be part of doing the work of Christ is doing the work of Christ. It's not really about the reward part is just about being a part of what God is doing. Whoever wants to be a part of what Jesus is doing, they're in. Simple. But Jesus does have some warnings in this passage, right? Some of these warnings about stumbling. Now, we might immediately think about this stumbling as sins, as different individual sins that we do, specific immoral things. And it can mean that, but I think really to the heart of it is something even deeper. Given a lot of reading, a lot of thought, I'm pretty convinced that there's a more central and more important meaning behind this word stumbling, which comes from the Greek root that's scandal. It's actually the Greek word. And the other place that this word is used in the Gospel of Mark is in chapter 14. What Jesus says to his disciples, just around the time of the Last Supper, you will all become deserters because of me. He's talking to his disciples, telling them in advance that when he's on trial, they're going to run away. They're going to be nowhere to be found. And that is actually what happened. So I think a better way to look at this word, the stumbling, is to fall away. To fall away from Jesus, to fall away from Jesus' love, to fall away from Jesus' mission. So I think we kind of keep that in mind as more primary in this sense of stumbling, which Jesus is talking about here, than maybe other specific sinful things. And so the first warning that Jesus gives, speaking to his disciples now, is if any of you put a stumbling block in front of one of these little ones who believes in me. You put a cause for falling away and in front of them. It would be better if a great millstone were hung around your neck. So don't cause so much, especially somebody who's smaller, younger, or weaker, or whatever. Don't cause someone to fall away. I'm going to tell you straight up, this is why I have a real problem with people who tell someone else that they aren't good enough to be loved by God. I mean, how dare someone push people away from the arms of Jesus? How dare someone say that the love of God is not big enough? I know people who've been pushed away from the church, who've been pushed away from Jesus. Personally, I feel like part of my mission is to at least try to show these folks that that's not what Jesus is about. We can look at the disciples here where they're trying to stop a man from casting out demons because he wasn't following them. Just how arrogant that is to think that it had to be done their way, following us, part of our group. I think if I were to push people away from Jesus because they weren't doing things my way, it'd be better for me. Yeah. The great millstone hung around my neck and I was thrown overboard because, really, to push people away, the love of Jesus, to cause people to fall away, to cause people to not know that they're loved by God. It's pretty rough thing. It's a pretty dangerous thing spiritually to cause someone to not be able to know God's love. Then Jesus warns the disciples about them falling away themselves. About falling away because you get too caught in something else. So he says, if your hand causes you to stumble, cut it off. Still think this is mostly about falling away from trust in Jesus and his mission, so I can think of an example. If your hand, still kind of metaphorically speaking, right? But your hand might be a little bit greedy. If you want to trust in having all the stuff instead of trusting in God and God's kingdom, cut that stuff out of your life and trust in Jesus instead. And by the way, where it talks about being thrown into hell in this place, it's actually one of the least precise and least helpful translations that I know of. Lots of issues of translation in Scripture. The word here is really Gehenna, which is Hebrew for the Valley of Hinnom, which was a valley near Jerusalem. And in the Hebrew Scriptures, this has been a place where there had been worship place for idols that had been set up. And it was also a place where even some people, and we're talking about people who were Jewish people who had gone astray, some of them had even gone to sacrificing children, like human sacrifice, in this place, in the Valley of Hinnom. So that is the, it's in the prophets, Isaiah, it's in Jeremiah, that the Valley of Hinnom had a terrible reputation as a place of idolatry, as a place of death. Some think that then it was a place where corpses of diseased animals were disposed of and things like that because it was not a place where anyone would want to be. So there was fire and rot. It's a good metaphor for punishment, but it's better we understand talking about a valley than on a case. Now, with that said, if your foot causes you to sin, causes you to fall away, let's say that I worship the idea of pulling myself up by my own bootstraps and think I don't need help from God or from anybody else. I've got it. Well, better cut off not just the bootstrap, but the whole boot and the foot and everything than it is to try to rely on yourself rather than relying on God. fall away. For example, if you look at someone else as beneath you, if we look and don't see a beloved child of God, we look at somebody else. It'd be better to pluck out that eye than it would be to miss out on God's love and prayer. Now, in spite of all these warnings about falling away, Jesus isn't really seriously, I don't think really seriously calling for amputations and mutilations. But he's trying to make people think, right? A lot of us wouldn't have anything left, you know? But I think he's trying to make them think. Jesus, he's not condemning people forever here. Remember how he told the disciples that they would fall away and desert him. And they did. But they were not cast out into Gehenna, into the Valley of Hinnom, or whatever place of punishment you want to talk about forever. They were brought back in, even after they deserted Jesus in his moment of need at the most serious time, in his trial, at his cross. They had deserted him, and Jesus still brought them back. It's not about punishment forever. See, if we wouldn't know that they had fallen away, if they weren't the ones to tell us about Jesus, we wouldn't know how badly they had missed the point if they hadn't told the story, right? These are the ones, these deserters, who then told us about Jesus. Then they told us the truth about their own story and their own failings as part of that story, as part of learning what it really means. So if we've pushed people away in the past, or if we have fallen away from trusting in the goodness of God's kingdom of Jesus, if we try to stop somebody from doing good in Jesus' name, we're not recognizing the good that someone is doing. That doesn't have to define us forever. Jesus is the love of God in flesh who brings God's kingdom among us. And that means that there is a place for everyone in God's kingdom. There's a place for everyone doing God's work. Even for deserters. Even for those who fall. This whole passage, it seems disjointed at first, but I think Jesus is reteaching his disciples, focusing them back, because they're missing the point of that God's love is transforming. They're missing the point of God's kingdom. They're missing the point of who all can be a part of God's kingdom. So he's reteaching them. There's a different way to live. And this different way to live isn't about who or what is important. It's not about deciding who's in, who's out. Because God wants everybody to be in. Everyone who wants to be a part of what God is doing. Be a part of what God is doing. Bringing good news to Jesus. Sharing good news to Jesus. Sharing the love of Jesus. Thanks be to God. I understand as we confess our faith and the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe
in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, the only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Peace to the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let's share a sign of Christ's peace.
We'll see.